Hey up, it's your old friend McgoganLives, and welcome to a new series on the channel called The North Remembers. It's a review show, and I've wanted to create a show like this for, you know, years now. I mean, long before I even started making videos or even had a YouTube account. Initially, it was going to be inspired entirely by the Nostalgia Critic. No. I mean, you know, vintage Nostalgia Critic from years back. But when I realised that I'd mostly be talking about games, I decided a better comparison might be, say, Ross Scott's Game Dungeon, Lazy Games Reviews, or maybe even the JonTron Show. If I had to summarise The North Remembers, then I'd say something like, it's an old man reminiscing about stuff from his halcyon days. I think that's a pretty accurate description. Nostalgia is a potent emotion, I mean, especially in the digital age. And for someone who spends most of his time with his head in the clouds like me, it got to the point where I felt like I had to make a series like this or else I was going to go mental. Just a quick word of warning before we start. I do use a camera extensively in this episode and plan to in future episodes, which means my appearance, warts and all, is going to be there for you all to, you know, laugh at. I've noticed that people can get a little pernickety regarding YouTubers showing their faces, so I thought I'd give you a bit of a heads up. Right, well, let's dive right into episode one. It's got to be something good for a series debut, right? You know, making fun of a Disney sequel is a lot like making fun of a disability. It's easy, but you know you shouldn't do it. One of these direct-to-DVD Disney dick splashes, however, has been a constant source of amusement in my life. You know something, as a child, I couldn't get away from this movie. And now as an adult, I can't forget it. I mean, it's like a monkey in my bonnet, or a bee in my back, a pain in my ointment, a fly in my arse. Well, as you've probably surmised, an extremely goofy movie is a direct sequel to 1995's A Goofy Movie. If you're not too familiar with that, it's a rather typical father and son movie set in a world governed entirely by sapient dogs.
Where are my testicles, Summer?
Nah. Now, believe it or not, The North Remembers was going to start with a goofy movie, but I've grown soft and sentimental in my old age, and while the movie's not great, it's not terrible either. The sequel, however. Well, today I am going to exorcise one of my childhood demons and finally put this extremely poopy movie to rest. Do you get it? Because, you know, poopy and goofy, they sort of rhyme, but they don't really. What would you call that? Assonance. That's what that is. Well, whatever. It was wordplay, and you should find it funny. We start this animated arse bounty with a J. Arthur Rank reference. Carry on goofing. This is actually the first of many references that I don't think were intended for the target audience. Yeah, you know, I think the screenwriters were like, what? Target audience? This is a direct-to-DVD sequel. We'd be lucky to have any audience. Anyway, look, let's get on to the movie itself or we're going to be here all fucking night. The movie opens with Max Goof, voiced by Jason Marsden, alongside his high school chums PJ, voiced by Rob Paulsen, and Bobby, voiced by... Paulie Shaw. Bertay! They're heading off to college the following day and have their little hearts set on winning the College X Games. Yeah, you know that 30-second scene from the first movie with Max riding his skateboard? Apparently that's what he wants to do with his life. Meanwhile, Goofy and PJ's old man Pete have a little heart-to-heart about their differing emotions regarding their sons leaving for college. Goofy seems crestfallen, while Pete is...
Come on, son! I can't miss you if you won't leave!
Yeah... Now, if there's anyone in the audience who's heading off to college or university sometime soon and a little fretful about taking their first steps into independence, let me just assure you that your parents are totally not going to be overjoyed to see you go. They're not going to put a pool table in your old bedroom, and I guarantee you, your sudden absence is not going to spark a sudden bout of promiscuous sexual activity. Oh, don't you worry. So, Goofy grabs the boys for lunch, but can't help but be impressed by his son's skateboarding acumen.
Oh, Waxy's pretty good at that Morden stuff.
He is totally gonna kill at college.
Well, old Father Time sure made that sound a little dark. Now Goofy gives Max a bit of a talking to about why he's really going to college.
You'll get a degree, and the world will be your clam.
Oyster, Dad?
Well, no thanks, I'm saving room for weenies.
Now if you think the jokes in this flick are contrived and flat, don't be fooled. They really are. Now, Goofy has a bit of a thing for the game of horseshoes for some reason. Probably because it serves as this movie's false metaphor for life.
Every once in a while, life gives you an important tossing opportunity.
Good night, everybody. So, lunch is concluded and we cut to later that night, where Max is fairly set on taking the whole house with him to college. I don't think you need to take the carpets with you, pal.
That dame's taken everything but the kitchen sink!
His father has a present for him.
Scare packs things right at home, man, they are so cool!
So, is it customary for fathers to take pictures of their sons when they're caught with sudden unexpected surprise? Wonder how Max reacted when he found out Goofy was taking pictures of him losing his virginity.
You'll have to stand to speak, huh?
So Max turns in and, oh, what the hell is that? God, let's move on to the morning, move on to the morning. Max and his cohorts mount a camper van and roar off into the next stage of their lives, leaving Goofy behind.
Goodbye, my little college man.
he's not dead, mate. Pal, he literally left like a minute ago. Jesus Christ, man, this isn't the crossing guard. I mean, I've heard of empty nest syndrome, but this is just bizarre. We cut to our three young freshmen as they make their way to college, nearly killing themselves in the process. Well, that is how students tend to drive.
Oh, well, that's just horrible. I mean, that's a farmer's livelihood you're destroying there.
Still, this does go some way to explain that other movie.
You're wasting your time here. I'm not going to report this or anything you do to my crops to the news or TV or anybody.
By some miracle, they arrive at their college and see about settling in. Meanwhile, Goofy is finding it hard to adapt to life without his son. Oh, gee. Not many pictures of Max's mother, is there? And a little too many of Max, in my opinion. But, hey, maybe I should cut the guy some slack. I mean, it can't be easy coping with such a dramatic change in one's life, can it?
Hiya, Dad.
Maxie.
You know, Goofy, I'm trying to build a case for you here, son. I think these hallucinations might be a sign of something a little bit more serious than simple loneliness. Unfortunately, Goofy's episode is spotted by his boss, who doesn't take kindly to it. In his haste to get back to work, hilarious antics ensue. Devastation. Several employees missing, presumed dead, an entire factory out of commission, and hundreds out of work. And what's Goofy's punishment for this?
You're fired!
Of course. He should be brought up on charges of gross negligence and manslaughter. But, he misses his son. Max and the gang, however, are having no problem getting into the flow of college life with their hip, young sports activities. Now, this is a movie set on a campus. So I'll give you one guess as to who the antagonists are. The rich kids, of course.
Well, well, well.
Turns out they're keen skateboarders too, and tail the gang to a local bar. Well, alright. It's time to get the fucking ales in and show this college that we are here to party. Yeah, that's right. These are millennial college students. Pretentious coffee-drinking twats as opposed to fat drunken retards. I mean, at least the latter were fun. And if that's not bad enough, the place is populated by hipsters, armed with improvised poetry, no less.
Life. Life is like a lime. It's tart and tangy. Quiet. Speechless like a mime.
Don't you dare waste my time, cause life can stop!
On a dime.
Rain washed my street art away. I got a job at Starbucks today. Future prospects looking thin. Parents are to blame for everything.
You see, I can do it and all. The rich kids, Gamma House, seize the chance to introduce themselves to Max.
Bradley. Bradley Uppercrust the Third.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Bradley is flanked by his Gamma cronies, especially his bodyguard Tank, voiced by gentle giant Brad Garrett. And that's the only good news I've got for you concerning this movie. They immediately try to coerce Max into joining the Gammas and leaving behind his friends. You know the drill. He refuses and things get messy.
The Jets are gonna have their day tonight. The Jets are gonna have their way tonight.
Fortunately, the Beret Girl, that's actually the name she's given, by the way, intervenes. What the hell does that even mean?
Knock it off!
What's wrong, Brad?
Don't you dare call me that!
Don't you ever call me by my name!
A wager is made between Max and Brad.
Don't you dare call me that!
All right. That whoever loses the X Games that year will be Talboy to the other. This is our drama for the movie. After this, we cut to where all students find themselves after graduating. Goofy, thankfully not imprisoned or sectioned under the Mental Health Act, is informed that his chances of employment are slim unless he gets a degree at college. You can see where this is going, can't you? So, back at college, the Gammas are giving our hero a hard time.
Let's steal his lunch money after class.
What are they all studying in order for them all to be in the same class anyway? Theoretical skateboarding? The history of rad? Oh, but guess who interrupts?
Hi, everybody!
So the truth is out that Goofy and Max are father and son. And to be fair, Max does take it on the chin that his father has to be at college in order to find a job. Goofy, on the other hand, immediately sets about attaching himself to Max.
A whole nother year, just you and me.
Pretty disturbing, isn't it? Well, believe me, it only gets worse from here. Through montage, we're shown that Goofy virtually refuses to leave Max's side, to the point where it starts to interfere with his social life. Or, rather, his chances of getting laid.
Huh? Hiya, Max.
Look, I know there's such a thing as a doting dad, right? But then there's scenes like this. Max, needing to get some practice in for the upcoming X Games, attempts to ditch his pop in the library.
Where are you going, son?
Jesus! You know, there's wanting to spend time with your kids, and then there's never letting them out of your sight. This is just obsessive, mate. Luckily for Max, Goofy needs a library card, and, leaving him with the librarian who's almost as mental as he is, he manages to escape. Goofy, on the other hand, gets a date with the librarian, Sylvia, and of course the first thing he does is run to tell his son.
Maxie escaped? I'd better get the nail.
Through the power of paternal intuition, Goofy finds Max busting some moves on the ramps here, but is too busy fantasizing about blowing his load on the librarian's face to notice how fast his son is going. Okay, so of course everyone thinks Goofy is some sort of boarding sensation. Including Brad.
Don't you dare call me that.
Oh, shut up. And his gammas. And guess what? Goofy instantly takes advantage of his newfound fame and love of the skateboard to try and worm his way onto Max's team in the X Games. It doesn't work out that way, but Brad...
Don't you dare call me that.
Oh, just can it, will you? ...is quick to try and snap Goofy up into his gammas.
That's real nice of you to ask, but I'm really only interested in staying close to Maxie.
Seek help. But Max and the gang convince Goofy to join their rival so they can be finally free of the guy. You can't blame him, can you?
Gammas, exit!
Later on, the gang celebrate their success at a local nightclub. Well, let's get the lagers in then, fellas.
Let's do it! Do it!
God, the analogues for booze in this movie suck. Hey, look, it's Beret Girl. Because she totally looks like the sort of person who would frequent something as mainstream, juvenile and downright... as a nightclub, doesn't she?
I forgot your name.
It is endemic of the current culture that those with large stature are overlooked, except by vultures, with no regard to the depth of their souls, the height of their passion, the beauty of their moments.
I'm just kidding with you, Toots. Pete Jr. Now, do you spit lyrical magic or do you swallow it, huh? Woof, woof. Of course, because this campus is so small with its thousands of students, guess who shows up on his date? Goofy Monero and his lovely librarian lover, Sylvia.
Life gives you an important tossing opportunity.
So there's a dance routine from the 70s that's about as engaging as it sounds and... Oh, 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 oh. And then the two find themselves on a bench.
Why you gotta be such a cock tease?
Don't you call me no goddamn cock tease.
Through another. Montage. It is shown that Goofy becomes a fully-fledged member of the Gammas. And now the big day is here. Well, the qualifying round for the big day. Still important, though. Does Max and the team have the right stuff to ace the qualifiers? Of course, Brad.
Don't you dare call me...
Oh, just put a donk in it. And his Gamma team, including Goofy now, are there too.
Welcome to the 6th Annual College X Games. Contestants are going to spin.
Well, Max is quite the favourite amongst the 8 people who showed up to watch the event. I mean, not his teammates, just Max. His teammates are side characters.
Max goes!
Max! Max!
Silence before you strike. The noise afterwards. It rises. Rises up like a storm. As if you were the thunder god himself.
It seems the Gammas, however, are up to something sinister.
Focused.
Now, there's a word for this kind of skullduggery, but it escapes me.
Just like we always do.
Bradley hands the doctored skateboard to Brother Goof.
I think I like where this is going.
So Goofy begins his exhibition. And he blows. On seeing this, the Gammas activate the rocket board and Goofy soars his way into a high score, much to the chagrin of his son.
Perfect tens across the board!
Max begins his boarding, but once again the Gammas are up to no good.
Jump! Whoa, losing his balance too easy.
Now what is that word I'm thinking of? Oh well, it'll come to me. Max and his team just limps into the semi-finals. Max, humiliated by his uncool dad, storms off. Goofy is quick to catch up with him, of course. Max has finally had enough of his overbearing pop, and it's easy to see why after lines like this.
I didn't mean for it to turn out this way, Max. I was just trying to get closer to you.
How close are we talking exactly? Informer policeman kind of close? Max, however, tells his dad to fuck off. Well, he doesn't say it, but it's strongly implied.
And get your own life!
Finally, a voice of wisdom in this educational establishment. Goofy is crushed by Max calling him out on his creepery and is unable to concentrate in a test. Now, look, some of you may be thinking, McGoganLives, this is a direct-to-DVD sequel. I mean, surely you've got better things to do with your time. I mean, why don't you go back and make some funny comments? Well, Mr. Nelly Naysayer, let's see what you think after this little scene. Well, there's no point going on, is there? I mean, what are you going to say after that scene? This movie's just gone from 0 to 100 in an instant. Oh, no, oh, God, no, I can't do this. I mean, it's, unless I can find... Just, someone needs to revive me. I just need... Thanks. There. You see? This guy is fucking obsessed. Doodling his son's name in big flowery letters. I mean, that's what 12-year-old girls do. Fantasizing about having some tea party with him. It's like the end of The King of Comedy if Scorsese was on acid. I mean, this is the tipping point. This is when this movie stops being some cliched college movie and turns into a psychological thriller. I mean, that is not the face of a father that Harry Chapin would write a song about. That is the face of a father whose son's presence acts like his own personal Viagra pill. Well, guess what? It only gets better. Goofy spends so much time chasing Max through Dreamland that he completely fucks up his test, presumably handing in only a suspiciously stained piece of paper with his son's name written on it. And guess what? It gets even better. With his future prospects fucked, Goofy goes off and sulks for the entire day. So, Goofy was supposed to have dinner with Sylvia to celebrate finishing his exams? I mean, hell, she even got balloons and had a sign made up for him. And he just blew her off. What a cunt! So, Goofy pisses off home like the snivelling twat he is and asks his friend Pete what the future may hold for him.
All that book learning doesn't prepare you for doodly squat. It's useless in the real world.
Ha! Oh, don't be listening to him, kids. Now, it's very important that y'all get yourselves to college and indebt yourselves for life. No. Don't be listening to the self-educated man. After all, he only has a massive RV with an inbuilt bowling alley, a widescreen TV, a jacuzzi, camcorders, and God knows what else. And Pete works as a children's photographer? Should we alert the IRS? For some reason, a game of horseshoes reminds Goofy that he lost his focus, and he heads off to college to make amends.
Did I miss something?
Only that you're the smartest fucking character in this flick. Meanwhile, Max is also down in the dumps because his dad stole his thunder and nobody's paying attention to him anymore. Well, that's show business, kid. He returns to the hipster bar with bad news for his chums.
Grande cappuccino. Make it a double.
Oh, just drink some fucking booze already. Can't be nearly as sinful as all these pseudonyms. Max informs his team that he's leaving for another college. Sinking their X Games dream. He's in a bad state of mind, but that's nothing some phoned-in hipster philosophy can't cure.
Max. Admit defeat, and defeat will surely admit you into permanent custody, my man.
Why don't you go and take a leaf out of Sylvia Plath's book, huh? His friends aren't gonna let him go down without a fight.
Are you gonna be someone else's town?
Oh! Well, as if a pep talk from Pauly Shore wasn't bad enough. So of course Max changes his mind and the three ride out to battle.
Boys will be boys.
I should know. I secretly am one.
Back at the library, a jilted Sylvia is trying to get the Goofmeister out of her head.
Me, you could send a little note, something.
Oh, what a shit-eating bastard. I mean, I'm not even fucking him, and I want to shove those books back in his face. Goofy explains that he lost his focus, and gives her the big, sad, soulful eyes. Predictably, they reconcile, and Goofy states his intentions.
Most important, get my son back.
Get your son back? It was your obsessive behaviour that drove him away in the first place. This is how stalkers think.
Max, I know that restraining order you got for me is just you trying to test my devotion to you. Don't you worry, son. I'm gonna kill you, then me. Then we can be together forever.
We're treated to another montage, this time of Goofy Balboa studying. You know, I just love how devoted Sylvia's voice actress was in saying those lines. Yeah, Goofy, oh yeah. Yeah.
Go, yeah. Goofy's all ready to retake his exam.
So, is that how college works in America? If you fuck up your exams, you can just retake them next week? What? The test? No, I fucked it up. Gonna do it next week, don't worry about it. Should be easy now, I know all the questions. Well, anyway, Goofy aces his tests and proceeds directly into the next stage of regaining his focus. Quitting the gammas.
I have to quit the team.
Excuse me?
Why are they so upset by this news? I mean, they had to attach a fucking rocket to Brother Goof to make him perform. Surely they'd be delighted by Goofy wanting to leave.
If you were such darn winners before, you'll be just fine without me.
Looks like that education's paying for itself already. Eventually, the gammas concede to Goofy's decision, but not before getting the last word in.
No, you're not leaving the gammas.
Wow!
The gammas are leaving you!
Following his dismissal, Goofy overhears something sinister being discussed at Gamma House.
We'll cheat.
Cheat!
The gammas have been cheating the whole time? I had no idea! I mean, you know, the rocket board and distracting your competition, I mean, I just chalk that down to laddish tomfoolery. You know, I'm starting to think they might be the bad guys. When the big day arrives at last, Goofy is adamant that he has to warn Max that the gammas are cheaters. But, due to Goofy being as creepy as fuck towards him, Max is convinced that this is some sort of plot. This looks safe. When it's shown that Goofy isn't competing, people lose their shit. Max at last realises that his dad might be telling the truth about the gammas, especially when the games begin and suspicious occurrences start happening to all the teams not important enough to be featured in the movie. God, I hope they didn't cut his rope as well. Yeah, those gammas aren't very subtle when it comes to cheating, are they? It's a good job everyone at this college is a moron. It goes without saying that the only two teams left in the final are the Gammas and Max and his boys. Now it'll take a masterpiece of Machiavellian precision to usurp the prize from Max's team.
That's it.
Oh, you could just send one of them to the fucking moon. Do you think Wile E. Coyote was a Gamma when he was at college? In order to avoid disqualification, Max needs a replacement for PJ. But who could fit the bill? Just when all hope seems lost.
Yo,
Yes, dear old dad comes to the rescue after a heartfelt appeal from his son.
Dad, you're as creepy as hell, but we need an extra body in my team. If you agree, I'll let you take me pants shopping again.
So at last we come to the exciting finale. A triathlon for the trophy. The Gammas are still hard at it with their cheating, though their traps are utterly useless. One even leads Max and the group down a shortcut and puts them in front, and takes out one of the Gammas.
So what are you going to try next, Cheese?
Next up are the bikes, which of course leads to more cheating. You notice how Gamma Team only have two bikes at their disposal? Eerie. It's time for the next dramatic offing of another side character. This time, it's Pauly.
Can you fly, Bobby?
Seems to have failed off the car!
Look at all that mud. It's like a metaphor for his career.
Keep going, Max!
So we're at the skateboards, the final part. Oh, come on. Only four skateboards are waiting for the races. Who set up this course? Nostradamus? As the competitors trundle through the track, Bradley is sent flying and seems to be out of the race. At the realization that nobody's paying attention to him, his ugly intentions are revealed.
Nobody finishes this race but me!
Fortunately, Goofy is there to thwart Brad's plan.
Don't you dare call me...
Jesus, man! I know he's the bad guy and all, but you just socked him in the face with a piece of iron! Hell, you even knocked one of his teeth out, for fuck's sake! Goofy's grievous bodily harm does diddly to stop whatever that button does, which this time fires another rocket, this time located on the back of Max's skateboard. What is it with these guys and rockets anyway? I mean, do they have to spend so much of their budget on rockets per year so they have the same amount of budget to work with next year? Max and Tank are sent careening into the giant X Games sign.
No!
Well, that was an extremely goofy movie. It was such a strange movie to sit through and... Okay, that's not the end. Just one of my abrupt endings. Still, the giant X is toppled over and on fire. It's a good thing the emergency services are there to step in and... Oh, there are no emergency services. Well, maybe the crowd will come together in this time of crisis and mount a rescue. Or they'll stand there gawping like idiots.
Two people are gonna be incinerated! Best X Games ever!
As Goofy charges in, we see that Max and Tank are still alive, though the latter is trapped under the debris. Max must make a choice. Is this where our hero realises that there are more imperative issues in life besides winning? Is valuing life the true prize to take away from the events of today? Nope!
Help me!
Yeah, we can't let that Bradley dweeb win. To hell with people. Victory. That's all that matters. And would you believe it? Max wins the race.
Where's my kiss, son?
Now, for some reason, Bradley decides to be noble in defeat. But somebody else wants a word.
Brad.
Don't you dare call me that.
Tank's alive! And sends Bad Brad flying without aid of a rocket into the passing airship.
I'm not gonna say...
Oh, the humanity. There, are we all happy now the obvious joke's been said? God. We're at the final scene, everyone. And look, the side characters are alive as well. It's graduation day, and Max has a gift for his pop. His X Games trophy.
Read the inscription.
Come no closer than 500 yards at all times.
And with that, Goofy joins his strumpet in the car. Something about letting Max get on with his own life. But not before making one last creepy joke.
Son, guess what? I got me a job right here on campus.
But you...
So I could be close to you.
But I thought that you were... You told me you were gonna...
Just kidding.
Right. So, Goofy and Sylvia literally ride off into the sunset. Presumably, Sylvia is never seen or heard from again. But who cares? It's the end! So, that was an extremely goofy movie. Do you know what I think? Yeah. Just a whole load of this. Well, I can't really complain about it, I suppose, what with it being a direct-to-DVD movie. But, you know, Goofy's seriously messed up behaviour is something I've never really forgotten. I mean, it's just so jarring and superfluous amidst this otherwise wholly generic movie. Thing is, going with the idea that Goofy actually is a deluded psychopath with desires that would make Freud take a lunch break actually turns this flick into something really entertaining. I mean, it's like Single White Female, only with dogs. Now, this was a college movie, so it wouldn't be right to not end without a Where Are They Now skit. I've been McgoganLives. Cheers for watching.
Don't you dare call me that!